Good to see everyone. We're gonna get we'll get started. We'll have some time for a conversation at the end. And 20 degree October Sunday. People are out doing other stuff. I get it. So, but it's good a few of us can be here this morning. Before we do anything else, I just want to let me open with a word of prayer as we get settled in. And let's just focus our minds and our hearts on Christ and what the Spirit has to say to us today. Let's pray. God, we pause not to ask or invite you to be here. We never have to ask, beg, or plead you to be here. You're never far from us. We simply need to intentionally acknowledge and make space in our minds, in our hearts, open up our ears and eyes to see and hear you, just as John saw these visions in Revelation. You are a God who continues to speak, continues to reveal yourself in your heart. And so I pray that we would be awake and aware, not just on Sunday mornings. This is kind of the easy part of the week when we're all together, to be aware of your presence. But help us to be mindful of your presence outside of Sunday morning, when we leave this place, in our workplaces, in our neighborhoods, in the stressful and anxious moments of our lives. We pray that in those moments we would pause and intentionally acknowledge your presence and your care for us. But for this next few minutes we're together this morning, we pray that you'll give us ears to hear, that we'll hear what you have to say to us. We pray for the many who might be traveling today, those who are sick and could not be with us. We just pray that wherever they are, they would sense your presence, because your presence is not contained to the buildings or spaces we might be tempted to say are sacred. All places are sacred, and we can encounter you everywhere. But it's good that we can be together here. And so we acknowledge your presence. Most of all, we thank you for revealing your heart in Jesus, your life, death, and resurrection that changes everything. And we pray that we would live out of that, that we would bear witness to your love and grace. In your name we pray, amen. Yes. Amen. We're going to be sitting for a while, so why don't we stand for a couple of minutes, and let's just, as we typically do, let's remind ourselves why we gather. Let's recite this together. We have gathered in the name of Jesus Christ. We have come to this house to worship God. We have come to confess that Jesus is Lord. We're not here to be entertained. We are here to encounter the sacred. We are not consumers. We are worshipers. We praise and adore the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And this morning, amen. This morning again, we want to acknowledge that as we gather here in this place to worship, we're doing so on the traditional territory of the Tigamishing, Anishinaabeg, and Wanapate peoples who have stewarded this land for generations. We honor them and commit to learning how to be better stewards of the land we share with them and with all of God's people. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to read a passage from the lectionary this morning. The lectionary from the Psalms this week is from Psalm 99. The Lord is king, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he, mighty king, lover of justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called on his name. They cried to the Lord and he answered them. He spoke to them in a pillar of cloud. They kept his decrees and the statutes that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. Amen. Amen. We're going to spend a few minutes worshiping in song, and then I've got some announcements, and then Sarah's here. There's kids' church offered, so you guys can hang here. You can go to the kids' programming down the hall. But before we do anything else, I just want to spend a few moments worshiping in song together. And last week's message from Revelation 4 and this week's message from Revelation 5, they're kind of tied together in that same vision. And so I thought once again we would enter into worship and song, just meditating on a song that was inspired by this passage of Scripture. And sometimes when you're looking for a title, it doesn't need to be anything wild. It's just called Revelation Song. Most of us are familiar with this song. It's a song that comes right from the text we're going to be engaging today. And so I want to let these words, maybe these words that are very familiar to us, just to percolate our minds and in our hearts. And so let's just sit. You can stand, you can sit, you can pray through this, you can sing along, however you're comfortable. Let's just take a couple moments just maybe to offload anything that's weighing on you as you come in here today. Maybe there's some anxiety that's been chasing you all week. Maybe there's someone on your heart that you're really burdened for, and you can bring them to God in prayer this morning, as I will be doing. Let's just spend a few minutes sitting with Jesus, worshiping in song, and open the eyes of our heart to see what the Spirit has to show us today. As I plug in my speakers.
With all creation I see. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amen. One of the reasons we gather is simply to do that, to just spend time in adoration. In adoration of the one, the source of every good and perfect gift. And I hope and encourage and urge us to make time to do that throughout our weeks. You know, life can get frenetic, it can get hectic. We can be celebrating a lot of the good gifts of God and forgetting to adore and acknowledge the source of it all. And so this is one reason we can come and should come together every Sunday, is just to celebrate the source of it all. The Lamb that we're focusing on in the book of Revelation. A couple of announcements to bring to your attention. We're launching into another life plan season. For those of you relatively new to the church, life plan is a tool that we use, a gift from our denomination, to help churches sort of discern what time it is, what should we be focusing on. This is a perfect time for us to be going through this, running in tandem with the sale of the church property and us sort of changing our space in the building. We're going to have potentially a lot more resources to put into pouring into discipling one another, pouring into the wider community. And so it's a good time for us just to kind of come together and work through this process. It's a 6-step process. The first step we're in right now, know what time it is. That involves some congregational surveys. Those congregational surveys are available on our church website. If you go to the church website, you'll see an image like this. You click on that image, and that'll take you to a page that has a Word file, the congregational survey. You can download that, you can fill it out, and then you can email it back. And we want to compile all those results. We want your honest opinion on, from your vantage point, the life of our church. I know it's been a different time the last couple of years during the pandemic, but historically or even now, what are the things we're doing well? Who are the people that we're most attractive to? What are the ways that we can connect with our community? What are our blind spots? We want to know about those as well, things that we should be doing a better job in and give more time and resources to. That's all encompassed in this congregational survey. And so we're going to keep those congregational surveys open for the next few weeks. We're going to receive those. At the same time, I have been and will continue to talk to some community leaders and just sort of keep our ears open out in the community on how we can continue to connect with and serve and fill some needs in the community. And then, you know, from there, we're going to compile all that data. We're going to return it to the congregation. And when you get that, you'll get that in a nice package. You'll see charts and graphs and a narrative about that, the results of the congregational surveys and the conversations with community leaders. And then we're going to do the spiritual work of praying. We're going to pray over that for a couple of weeks. And we're going to do what we've been doing this morning. We're going to listen. We're going to maybe journal, take notes. What's jumping out of you? What's the Spirit putting on your heart? Because this is our church. It's God's church, but we're all a part of it. We all have a voice in this process. We trust each other through the process. And then we're going to have a dream session. You know, once we get through the building sale, we'll let you know when that will be. We were hoping to get it in November, but just with everything else going on with the transition, I think we'll probably bump that to early in the new year in January. We'll have a dream session. We'll dream up a plan together. And then in 2023, throughout the winter, we'll stay on target. And we'll press into the few things that God wants us to focus on. You know, we can't be everything to all people, but we can do a few things well that we sense the Spirit is guiding us on. So the first step is important. We get those congregational surveys back, as much feedback as possible. So take a few minutes this week, if you can, fill those out and email them back to the church. Also, we're almost ready to roll into November. So the first Sunday in November, that's 2 weeks from today, will be our next Theology on Tap night at the First Round Restaurant just up the road. 7 p.m., topic for conversation, how has the pandemic challenged and or changed your view of God? It's okay to evolve in your understanding of God. I mean, this whole grand story we've been on is an evolution of how people have understood God, culminating in Jesus. So maybe the pandemic for all of us has challenged or changed our view of God and how God interacts with the world, and we want to have that open conversation around tables with food and drink. So believers are welcome, explorers are welcome, skeptics are welcome, anyone's welcome around the table just for some open theological conversation, Sunday, November 6th. Invite some friends. They may not be interested in coming to a Sunday service, but they may want to come out and have some food and drink and a conversation together. So that'll be on Sunday, November the 6th. Also next Sunday, Tyler, this one's for you, buddy. soccer fan. Any soccer fans in the house? We're going to have a pancake brunch on Sunday, November 27th, which is kind of cool timing because that'll be our first Sunday post-sale of building because the closing date on our sale is November 21st. And we're hoping between now and then, we're going to put some new flooring in the dining hall and get that space spruced up a little bit. And we're going to have a pancake brunch. We'll have a worship service, an abbreviated worship service. And then we'll have a screening of the Canada soccer game against Croatia that morning. And so I'm looking for volunteers to help me flip some pancakes that morning. And we'll reach out. We'll pack as many people in as we can and feed as many people. We'll have a time of worship and a time of cheering on the Canadian soccer team at the World Cup. So note the date, Sunday, November the 27th, regular time. And that'll be a great time to celebrate together. I want to give thanks for the generosity of God in the life of this church. This has been such a generous church, long before I've been around. The history and the ethos of Valleyview Community Church has been and continues to be a church that is generous towards the community and towards one another. And so I want to give thanks for that, especially during the pandemic, getting us to this point now where we're able to get to this point where we can sort of unburden ourselves from the management and what's weighing us down with the facility, still be in the facility. And so know that as you give with confidence, knowing that the money that comes in, the resources, we're getting to a place where we're going to be running things a little leaner. And so we'll have more margin. More of those resources can go directly to the things that come out of our life plan. And so thank you for your generous giving. And for those of you that are in a position to give today and this week, you can give via e-transfer at valleyviewfinancial@gmail.com. Around here, we don't say give X percent. We simply say, echoing 2 Corinthians 9:7, give what you decide in your heart. Don't give reluctantly. There's no compulsion around here. God's not a coercive God. God loves a cheerful giver, and God is a cheerful giver, and He's given us so much. And so it's a joy to give, not only on a Sunday, but to give our lives to serving and imitating the Lamb, as we'll talk about again this morning. So let me pray over all the good things in the life of our church. Let me pray over the offerings. Then I got a cool little video the kids will love, and then we'll dismiss the kids to Children's Church and get into the message. Let's pray. God, we thank You that everything You command us to do, You also model to us. And so when You encourage us to give cheerfully, that's because we recognize that You're not a stingy God, You're a cheerful giver. You've given us so much. This world, with all the sights, smells, sounds, colors, it all comes from You. You could have created a world of black and white, and we wouldn't have known the difference. But we see so many colors and tastes and sights and sounds. All of those things we take for granted, they come from You, our creative, loving, cheerful giver of a God. And we thank You that we have the privilege of being managers and stewards of what You've entrusted to us. Thank You for the good things happening and continuing to happen in the life of our church. We commit this life plan process to You that we'll trust each other and we'll be hearing Your voice. And as You have done in the past, every time we've gone through this process, You have been faithful speaking to us. And we've been faithful trusting one another and listening to You. So give us ears to hear how we can best love God and love neighbor in this season as a church. We pray that we'll have wisdom, all the resources that come in through giving and through the sale of the property and other initiatives. We pray that we'll have wisdom on how we can love well. At the end of the day, we're called to love You and love our neighbors. That's how You boiled it down, Jesus. And so we pray today and the days ahead we'll be able to do that well. We thank You most of all for Your life, Your death, and Your resurrection, which allows us the ability to partner with You in bearing witness of your love to this community. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, kids. I got a little video. What's your favorite toy? I know your favorite toy. Where is it? Did you bring it? Your little Ewok? You have it here?
Lego.
Pat's a Lego. Lego is the ultimate intergenerational toy. Okay, I'm going to show a video from a commercial when I was your age. And it's going to look really dated and really cheesy. But this will tie in and lead into the message and lead into some of the conversations that Sarah's going to have with the kids as well. All right, here we go.
The Transformers, for it meets the eyes. Autobots raise their weapons to destroy the evil forces of the Decepticons. Transformers, more than meets the eye.
commanders. Robots in disguise.
Attack the Autobot commander.
Call in the Decepticon leader.
Transformers. More than meets the eye.
The Transformers, sold separately from Hasbro.
Heads up if you had that Decepticon toy as a kid. I did. Yes. I see that head. You still have some of those?
Yeah.
You still have some? Yeah. Save them for the grandkids. So that's the Transformers, and you're wondering why we have like Transformers sponsoring the service? No, this will tie into the message. And if you're curious, kids, Sarah's going to have the same conversation that we're having here, appropriate for your age. So Sarah, lead the way. Kids Church is on down the hall, and we'll see you at the end of the service. And I hope that every Sunday, as we're having the same conversations, that'll spill over into conversations around tables and back at home. God, we thank you for our children. Bless them in the conversations. Thanks to Sarah and the other ministry team leaders. I pray they have a wonderful time learning about your love, and I pray that for us as well. Amen. Oh, just got quiet in here now. Okay, Revelation chapter 5 today. We are in our Follow the Lamb series. For those of you visiting, got some friends here, John and Sarah Lynn from Sault Ste. Marie. We've been going through the Bible cover to cover. Almost 3 years it's taken us. It'll probably be about 3 years when we finish Revelation. And for me, and others have said, obviously people have been coming in and out over the last 3 years, but it's been neat to see sort of the contours, the unfolding story, the trajectory is a word we use a lot, the trajectory of Scripture, which culminates in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And of course, you know, this is, in a sense, this is the end of the grand story, the book of the Bible, but it's an ongoing story. The story continues. We are part of the grand story. And the book of Revelation, at least how we're coming at it, is not talking about things necessarily yet to come, although there's some of that in Revelation, but it's things that would have had immense value to the early listeners and the recipients, and a way for them to see the world, like Transformers, more than meets the eye, right? There's some things that are in disguise. And so as we've been talking about the visions that John has been receiving, the vision of the Son of Man, the vision of this heavenly throne room. We talked that heaven is not a distant, faraway place we'll go to in the future as much as a dimension of reality, the God space that interconnects, intertwines with the physical reality in which we live. And that's good news. That's part of the gospel. The gospel is not when we die, we go somewhere. The gospel is good news in the here and now because God is present with us and working and continue to do that unveiling work. And that's what Revelation means, an unveiling. So just as John was given an unveiling of the spiritual heavenly realities in his midst, in the midst of his exile, in the midst of the persecution these seven churches that received this letter were facing, so too this can be an unveiling for us today and every generation between John and now. And so today's message is entitled, The Lion and the Lamb. The Lion and the Lamb. It's a kind of a continuation of the vision that John was given in Revelation 4. Revelation 4 and 5 really fit together, but it wouldn't have done it justice to do it all in one message. And so today, and I think, I'm going to go on record and say, I think Revelation 5 is critical. This is one of those chapters, I call it a hinge chapter. I got hinges on the brain. I'm making a bunch of stuff with hinges and buying hinges. It's a hinge chapter. Everything weighs upon how we understand and interpret this chapter. This is part of the interpretive key to the entire book of Revelation, as well as the whole Bible. And again, if you're coming into this series, we had a little bit of a cheat sheet the first week, and one thing on our cheat sheet was, there's nothing in the book of Revelation that cannot be corroborated or verified somewhere else in Scripture. And so don't go chasing novel interpretations out of Revelation that cannot be corroborated by certainly Jesus in the Gospels and much in the Old Testament. Revelation is meant to be sharing information in ways that subvert and turn things upside down. It takes imagery in the first century in the Roman world, and it gives counter images to challenge and subvert, to flip upside down. Bear that in mind again this morning. So, again, just to locate where all this is happening, modern day Turkey, seven letters, being received by John as he's in exile on this little island called Patmos, a prison island by the Roman Empire. Hi, Sarah.
Hi, where's my little craft cart?
Oh, probably across the hall. We put everything across the hall. Sorry. And so John is writing from here, a prison island on Patmos, and he's receiving all of these visions, and this vision today is so critical. And this vision in particular today would have been so encouraging and radical to all of these fledgling churches, feeling the pressure of empire, the pressure of the Roman Empire, just like we can feel the pressure to follow Jesus in our society, even more so back then. Their lives were at risk in following Jesus faithfully in the midst of an empire and ideologies that were so different from what Jesus represented. So I want to read Revelation chapter 5, nothing fancy. I'm just going to read the text as we always do. We lead with the scripture, and then we'll talk about some key things here in Revelation 5 that I think we can hold on to, which will help us live faithfully to Jesus in our time, just as these churches needed to hear these words. Revelation 5. This is all continuing in that heavenly throne vision we talked about last week. Then John, I saw in the right hand, and right hand is a symbol of power and authority, in the right hand of the one seated on the throne, a scroll written on the inside and on the back sealed with seven seals. What's seven mean in Revelation? Yes, fullness, completeness, there's a whole lot of sevens. We're going to see them repeatedly. Just want to make sure you're reminded of that. Sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy? Worthy is a key word in Revelation 5. Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals? And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep bitterly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. Then one of the elders said to me, do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. Then I saw between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders a lamb standing as if it had been slaughtered, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And again, we're trying to literalize and visualize these images. It's kind of going to be weird and wacky, right? And we can get an imagery of a lamb with seven eyes and seven horns. I've never seen a lamb with seven eyes and seven horns. If you ever do, don't go swimming in any of the water nearby. This is meant to symbolically represent something. We'll come back to that. He went out and took the scroll from the right hand of the one who was seated on the throne. When he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures, last week, again, recap, four living creatures. What did we assume they represent? Anybody here last week? The four living creatures? There was a creature that looked like an eagle. There was one that looked like an ox, one that looked like a man. And I'm forgetting the other one. Pat, help me out. You took a picture of the screen. Lion, of course. Yeah, lion, yeah. And those we surmised, based on ancient rabbinical teachings sort of encapsulate all of creation, right? The strongest of the domestic animals, the ox, the strongest of the wild animals, the lion, the most mighty of the birds in the bird kingdom, the eagle, and the mightiest creature of all, humanity. And so all of creation is gathered around the heavenly throne. So they got these four living creatures, 24 elders, quick recap, 24 had double meaning. The emperor of the Roman Empire had 24 bodyguards, more than any of the kings or proconsuls. He had 24. So it's contrasting and comparing the emperor in his throne room and the real king, the king of kings in his throne room. Not to say that God needs 24 bodyguards. 24 is also 12 tribes of Israel in the Old Testament, 12 apostles in the New Testament. By my math, 12 plus 12, 24. So it symbolizes the continuity, the grand story, Old Testament to the New Testament. All of the elders fell before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which symbolize the prayers of the people. Prayer is something beautiful and meaningful and mysterious. It's like incense rising to the throne of God. They sing a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slaughtered, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom of priests serving our God, and they will reign on earth. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice. And we sang this morning, not quite thousands of thousands here, but we echo these words already this morning. Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, to the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshiped. Amen. What a beautiful, all-encompassing picture of all of creation, rightly giving God and the Lamb representing Jesus the worship and the adoration that God alone is due. But I want to really focus this morning, more than anything else, on this imagery of the lion and the lamb in Revelation chapter 5. There's a lot of lion language in Scripture, and there's some lamb language in Scripture as well. And in Revelation chapter 5, what we just read here, we see these two. This would have hearkened the readers back to the Old Testament. We have the title Tribe of Judah, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, and the Root of David. And anybody familiar with the Hebrew Scriptures would have hearkened back to the Old Testament. A couple passages of Scripture I want to read. Near the end of Genesis, Judah, one of the 12 tribes of Israel, as there's blessing poured out upon the tribes and leaders, it says, You are a lion's cub in Genesis 49, O Judah. You return from the prey, my son. Like a lion, he crouches and lies down like a lioness. Who dares to rouse him? So this is in this imagery, this is connecting back to the lineage. And Jesus comes from the line of the tribe of Judah. And then the root of Jesse, again, looking at the lineage of Jesus. We read this often around Christmas time in the Advent season, Isaiah chapter 11. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Jesse, the father of King David, as the lineage moves on. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. And so they would have connected the dots. This imagery that John is seeing here in the churches in this letter, they would have connected back to the might, the power, the strength, the ferocity of the one who is the Lion of Judah. But the scandalous thing in Revelation chapter 5, and the beautiful thing, and the comedic thing, there's actually a comedic part of this letter. These visions play like drama, but they often play like comedy as well, satire, poking fun at the powers of this world who think they are the ultimate power, but ultimately they, like everyone else, need to bow down to the one who is the ultimate power, the ultimate one who is sovereign, our Lord and King, Lord Jesus. Because John, he sees a lion, but all of a sudden, he sees a lion and he turns and he's expecting to see a ferocious lion. What does he see? He sees this, something like this, that lamb. Now this one doesn't have seven eyes and seven horns. What do you think seven eyes and seven horns might mean? When we think of eyes, what do eyes symbolize? Sight, you know, complete fullness of sight, or perhaps wisdom. I think the seven eyes on the lamb encompass the perfect sight and the perfect wisdom of God. Likewise, horns on an animal like a sheep or ram signify strength and power. So complete full power and complete full wisdom and sight. But yeah, it's not a lion, it's a lamb. It's a lamb. And in my studies, in my prayer time this week, I was reminded that in the Bible, there are actually two words. Of course, we have English Bibles, but in the original Greek language, there's two words for lamb or sheep. There's the word here, amnos, which is like sheep, full-grown sheep. And there's the word arnios, which means little lamb. Want to wager a guess which one it is here in Revelation 5? It is. It's little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. Well, Virgin Mary really did have a little lamb, the lamb who would take away the sins of the world. So it's almost comical and surprising and so subversive that John's expecting And everybody up to this point, we would be expecting this lion, this ferocious image, and the messianic expectation of the New Testament, right? As people are waiting from the Old Testament prophets predicting a Messiah, we've talked about this often around here, the 12 disciples, they thought Jesus was going to come and he's going to march into the Roman headquarters, sword in hand and kick butt and vanquish with vengeance and violence and force. But then we were reminded here that that's not how Jesus conquers the world. Jesus conquers the world through the shedding of his own blood, not the taking of the blood of his enemies. What? How's that work? Well, this is the beauty and the mystery and the scandal of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the challenge for the church in every generation, including ours, is will we embody a lamb-like power of God? Or will we be duped and tempted into that lion-like, violence, manipulative, controlling force? That is the force of the empire. That is Antichrist. The spirit of Antichrist is always manipulative. It's always coercive. It's always power through fear and violence. And the church throughout history, when it's been at its worst, it's taken up the sword. And this got really dicey and challenging in the 4th century when Emperor Constantine allegedly had a vision. I think it's all garbage. I call malarkey on it. I don't believe it happened. I believe it was legendary, but he allegedly had a vision of God with a shield, with a cross upon that shield and said, "In this symbol you will conquer." And so what does he do? He makes Christianity the official religion of the empire and they start conquering through sword and violence and bloodshed. Anybody who wouldn't give allegiance both to the state and to the church, they would conquer. And you could see how the church that had been persecuted for 300 years, that would be tempting. Oh, no longer do we have to live in fear of death and persecution. We give allegiance to this emperor now who is making us the powerful. And we sit in the seat of power in the empire now. And that's the most nefarious temptation. That continues to be our temptation, right? I hear it often. If we just get the right Christian government, the right Christian people in power, and we can get our rights, and we can turn this into a Christian nation, and we'll keep all the immigrants out, and we'll keep all these people out that look, think, and act differently. This is not the kingdom of God's mentality. We see it in Scripture, going back to the Old Testament. Love, welcome the stranger. Even before Jesus, the prophets got that right. And I get concerned in our day and age, in our culture, and some of the church rhetoric I'm hearing is that we're losing our rights, we're losing our privilege, we're using our freedoms, we're being persecuted. And yeah, we are losing some of our privileges. And I don't agree with everything the government does, regardless of the government. But that doesn't give us a right to pick up the sword and use force and violence and lion-like power, giving no heed to the way in which Jesus has and does want to rule and run and interact with creation. We need to opt out of that, especially when the church gets put back into the corner, when we get marginalized. You know what? Bring it on. Jesus was always operating from the margins. Maybe that's where the church needs to get back to operating from in our world. We can talk about that a little bit later. But I say all that because this would have been a reminder to the early church, as it can and should be a reminder to us, that the power of God lived out looks like a little lamb being slaughtered. It's self-sacrificial love. The strongest, highest, most forceful power in the world is not the power of coercion, violence, manipulation, power, control. It's the power of mercy, the power of self-sacrificial love, the power of turning the other cheek, the power of loving one's enemies. Jesus modeled all this. But here's the problem. Here's the challenge. Sometimes we like to take this image of God and this image of God and we just kind of smush it all together, right? Like a transformer. And I've heard this before too. Well, when Jesus came the first time, he came in a humble way, in a meek way, like a little lamb. But when he comes back, he's got a bone to pick. Watch out, sword in hand, the lion's going to come a-roaring. And we're going to get to some violent passages in Revelation, but we need to lock this in today because it stands to reason. And when we come to church, we don't leave our brains at the door. We love God with our minds and our hearts. It stands to reason, and excuse me for maybe this is an overgeneralization, but I've come to the conclusion that there's really two ways you can engage this book, the Bible. One, you can do this. You can see God as mutating in Scripture. Well, God had a mean streak in the Old Testament, and as my friend likes to put it, God took a happy pill between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and then now in the New Testament, Jesus is meek and mild. And so you can see God as mutating. But you see, theologians and people in the early church, they had a word for God, and that word was immutable. Immutable. God's like not like the Decepticon, right? Transforming and morphing. God is consistent. So God is like Jesus. Stands to reason that God has always been like Jesus. Well, what do we do with the passages of Scripture that look unchristlike? Well, we've walked through a lot of those on this journey. And our conclusion is that all of this is inspired by God in some way, shape, or form. But some of it is windows. Some of it is windows, seeing the reflection of God's love and mercy, Old and New Testament. Some of these dark passages of Scripture, they're more mirrors to the ways that we project things upon God, or we haven't fully understood God. And it makes perfect sense that before the cross of Christ, before the incarnation, before Jesus came, it makes perfect sense that people wouldn't have God figured out. And some of that leaks out in Scripture. They had tribalistic views of God. I mean, Joshua, going to the promised land, just slaughtering people, men, women, children, even the trees weren't spared in some of those passages. Does that look like Jesus? You can answer that. Does Joshua conquering the Canaanites look like Jesus' call to love enemies? It doesn't. It's in our Scriptures. I don't want to rip it out of our Scriptures, but we need to reinterpret all of Scripture in light of what we know of Jesus. Jesus doesn't bow down to the Bible. The Bible bows down to Jesus and bears witness to Jesus. And sometimes the Bible tells us about the ugliness of humanity and our need to come to Jesus, our need to repent. Repentance is a change of thinking. A change of thinking how we interpret certain passages. A change of thinking how we interpret how God interacts with the world. This is a change of thinking for a lot of people. When John sees or hears a lion, he looks, and it's a lamb, a slaughtered lamb. That is the powerful subversive reminder. That as Eugene Boring says, one commentator I've been interacting with, he says, this is perhaps the most mind-wrenching rebirth of images in all of literature. That's a bold, audacious claim, but I think he might be onto something. The slot in the system reserved for the lion has been filled by the Lamb of God. And this is why I'm using this image as the backdrop for this series. Pure, spotless lamb. I know it's kind of grotesque and violent, a lot of blood splatter all over the place, because we live in a violent, vengeful world. And the backdrop of Revelation is a violent, vengeful empire. And we're going to see a lot of violence in Revelation as we move forward. But in the midst of all of it, in the middle of it, as we've been seeing in these images, is the pure, spotless Lamb who conquers not by taking blood, but by laying down his life and calling his church not to be a doormat. We don't let people abuse and walk over us. Of course not. We have boundaries. We have discernment. But nonetheless, we imitate the way of the Lamb. We resist the lion-like temptation to act lion-like in ways that are inconsistent with what we know about Jesus as revealed in his life, his teachings, his death, his resurrection. And by the way, the primary teaching of Jesus, the Sermon on the Mount. Start with the Sermon on the Mount and fan everything out from there. That's basically Jesus, the ethic of the kingdom of Jesus is in the Sermon on the Mount. That's where we get the passages of loving your enemy. And you know how anger starts in the heart and boils over. I mean, the Sermon on the Mount is the core of the core of the kingdom ethic of Jesus. Start there and allow that to inform how we live and how we interact with others. Not only others who look, think, and act like us, but others who are different than us. Theologian Richard Bauckham, he says this word, says these words here. He says, when the slaughtered lamb is seen in the midst of the divine throne in heaven, the meaning is that Christ's sacrificial death belongs to the way God rules the world. And so the only king worthy of our adoration and worship, just as the only one worthy to open those scrolls, I should talk a little bit about the scrolls and these seals, In the right hand, in this passage, was a scroll. You know, a scroll in the first century, not surprisingly, is a symbol of a royal decree, right? And the king would take the king's ring, the signet ring, and they would, you know, in some hot wax, they would put a seal on the scroll that only the king, only the one with the seal, was worthy of opening. And this is almost, again, this is almost comedic. This is a counter image. Well, yeah, the kings and the emperors of the empire and any emperor, yeah, they have a certain amount of authority in this world, but their authority pales in comparison to the ultimate authority. The only one who's worthy to open the scroll of history, to inaugurate the kingdom of God, the plans of God, the redemptive purposes of God, is the one by whom, for whom, and through whom creation started. Going back to Genesis, right? In the beginning, John's gospel starts, was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And Word in Greek means logos, the wisdom of God. So in the beginning was pre-incarnate Christ. So Christ is the one through whom all things are created. And only Christ is worthy to open up the scroll. And only Christ is worthy of creation's adoration. And so my challenge to us today, and it starts with me, I filter all my sermons through my own heart and life before I speak anything out on a Sunday morning. My challenge to all of us is not simply to declare Jesus is Lord. That's easy. Anybody around the world can say Jesus is Lord. There are a lot of people that say Jesus is Lord, but their life betrays their words. And this is not a judgmental statement against anyone or any church or any denomination or anything, because I've been guilty of this too. But we got to be careful. When we say Jesus is Lord, in the first century, those words were scandalous. By saying Jesus is Lord, we're saying Caesar is not. By saying Jesus is Lord, we're saying the lamb-like way of Jesus is what I will give my life to, not the lion-like way of empire or power, principalities and powers. Our witness in word and deed will say more to the world than our token Jesus is Lord or our Facebook posts or what we do on Sunday morning. All good things. But it's when we walk out those doors, how are we living? Is our life imitative of this, the little lamb? Or are we being duped into having a picture of God that is both lion and lamb, like a God that mutates? Or are we going to do our part as a church to consistently and intentionally listen and receive the grace and love of Christ and then extend that same self-sacrificial love to those we encounter in a world, whether or not they know it, is full of brokenness and injustice, and people, whether they know it or not, they're looking and they're in need of this, because all people are created for relationship with Christ. And when the church, when we can lay down our own power and working out of our own strength and our own resources and recognize and keep Jesus, the Lamb, at the center, that's when things start to be redeemed. And we'll start to see more of that unveiling, more of the redemptive purposes and plans of the Christ between now and the glorious return of Christ. Amen? Amen? Amen. More could be said, more will be said, but I think we'll end there today. I do want to do like we do every Sunday, and soon we're going to get back to doing communion on a regular basis. Again, as we get through the building sale and get all the rooms figured out, I miss having our times of communion together every week. We'll be doing that. Good to see Tyler here. I'm going to huddle up with him and other musicians, and we got to try and get a music schedule rolled out too, to get some live music. A lot of things will be rolling out. But for today, again, we're gonna spend a few minutes just sitting with Jesus. We can have an open conversation for a few minutes as well. Some questions for reflection discussion today and this week. How is the transformation of the lion to the lamb, this idea here in Revelation 5, how is it critical to a proper understanding of the gospel and to the true heart of God? How does Revelation 5 urge us not only to declare Jesus is Lord, but to ponder how God rules and how we can imitate Christ? My quote from earlier, we can come to one of two conclusions after reading the grand story. Either God is a mutating God, a changing God, or there is an evolution of consciousness or an understanding of the character of God. To what degree do you agree or disagree? We don't mind disagreements around here with this statement. And then finally, you know, understanding and imitating the way of the Lamb is the calling of the church. To chase after beastly power, we'll encounter some beasts in the weeks to come. To chase after beastly power is to do something that the scripture outlaws time and time again. It's called bearing false witness. it's a big deal in Scripture. To chase after beastly power is to bear false witness to God. How can the church, our church, the church, how can we repent? A change of mind, which leads to a change of being and living, of the allure of power and influence that more resembles the beast than the lamb. That's a big ongoing question every generation needs to come back to. So keep those in mind, and maybe you've got some other questions or comments, but let's just spend a couple minutes. I've said my piece this morning. Let's sit with Jesus. We like to do some imaginative prayer on Sundays, so you can just sit. I like to just close my eyes and just imagine a meeting with Jesus in my mind's eye. God speaks through our imaginations, and let's just listen to what the Spirit wants to say and seal on our hearts for the next couple of minutes, and then we'll just open up for some conversation. Spend together this morning in your presence and the presence of one another. I pray that these images that we've encountered again this morning wouldn't leave our minds or our hearts, but as we continue to ponder your lamb-like love and grace, what it looks like lived out in our lives, in our lives of our families, in our church, I pray that this will frame or reframe how we see you, how we experience your presence and your love, which will lead to repentance, some change of our mindsets, some change on how we engage with one another in the church and in our neighborhoods, how we love even those who would want to do us harm or scoff. May we love in the same way that you have loved us, sacrificially, with co-suffering love, coming alongside the hurting and the broken and the marginalized. That we can be like a cup of cool water to those who are thirsty. And like a warm, therapeutic bath to those who are in need of healing. You alone, Lord Jesus, are indeed worthy of our adoration, worthy of aligning our lives with. And we pray, Spirit, you'll continue to lead us and guide us as a church, so that how we live, how we interact with one another and our neighbors, would cause people to give them pause. Not primarily to look at a church, but to look at a God who loves them with an infinite, everlasting, unfailing love. This is our hope. This is our prayer. We keep you at the center of it all, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.